which has not been used for the longest period of time, that is the one that is selected for selected as the HTM. So we started discussing what it would require in order to implement this idea. So think of it this way. Basically, a simple implementation would work like the following. A page fault occurs, so through the usual exception handling mechanism, the appropriate part of the kernel gets called. That kernel will examine the page table for the process and find which page has not been used for the longest time. Which means what? Which means that table has to be updated every time there is a memory reference, so that the kernel can keep track of which page was used when. So this essentially means that for every memory reference, you need a write to memory in order to update some kind of a timestamp on the page table. So if for every memory reference we need an additional write to memory, that becomes prohibitively expensive. Remember that to start with, when we were talking about just address translation via page table, storing the full page table in memory, we said was not a good idea because you need two memory reads in order to do an address translation. So the same reasoning applies here also. So basically that amounts to saying that proper strict implementation of LRU is not practical because it results in too many memory writes. So in practice, out of the three that we discussed so far, LRU, FIFO and optimal, LRU is what is used in practice, but it's not strict LRU, it's some approximation of LRU. So the rest of the variants that we will discuss are all kind of approximations to LRU. So just kind of to keep in mind what the formal or what the strict implementation of LRU required is, notice that you need some kind of a timestamp field associated with each page table entry. Okay, so remember when we discussed multi-level paging, think of how the calculation worked. We counted the number of pages in a process's address space. So the page table has that many entries. Then each entry we assumed has, say, occupies 4 bytes. So that leads to the fact that the primary page table is too big to fit in a single page. So that itself is broken across multiple pages, and the secondary page table keeps track of the pieces of the primary page table. Naturally, if the secondary page table is large, then that will also have to be broken up. So, as long as we are sticking to, recall what a page table entry looks like. So this is the kind of higher order bits of the starting physical address. These bits are all zero, and therefore we were using them for other purposes. So for 8K pages, we have 13 bits at our disposal. And out of these, we've already used 5. 3 for permissions, 1 for valid-invalid, and 1 for present-absent. So that leaves 8 bits. With 8 bits, you can only count up to 256. So if you want to, so we now have 2 options. In order to implement LRU, you need a timestamp with each page table entry. So So either you store the timestamp in that 8-bit field, or you kind of increase the length of the page table entry and add maybe another 4 bytes to store the timestamp. Both are problematic. If you choose only 8 bytes to store the timestamp, then every 256 memory references, your kind of timestamp will overflow. So it will be reset to zero. On the other hand, if you increase the page table entry size from 4 bytes to 8 bytes in order to accommodate a more accurate counter, then remember our page table size is going to double. So it is possible that instead of 2 levels of paging, we'll need even further levels of paging. So either way, you can't kind of, there's no easy solution. The kind of more minor disadvantage is that, minor disadvantage compared to FIFO, for example. FIFO was, you maintain a queue of pages in the order in which they were brought in, and the head of the queue, which you can find in constant time, is read page. Here, you have to do a linear scan of the full page table to find which page has been used most least recently. But notice that, and keep this distinction in mind, any memory management scheme, you have to be careful about what overhead is added per memory reference. So that you have to be very careful about, and what overhead is added for a page fault handler. That is kind of much less crucial, because a page fault handler is going to take time anyway. So a linear scan is not good, but at least it's happening only once per page fault, so it's not that bad. So, this is a disadvantage that you have to kind of scan the entire page table to find the least recently used page. But it's not as bad as, say, this one. Right? For every memory reference, if you had to do a write to memory, that's a much more fatal problem. Okay, so what can we do as far as kind of approximations are concerned? The coarsest possible approximation is something like, don't have a counter, because the counter is going to, a counter will only make sense if you increment it once per memory reference, and then it will overflow pretty soon. So instead of that, supposing we have something like a reference bit. So reference bit is basically, every time a page is referenced, the corresponding bit is set to 1. Now, after a while, so basically, what distinction can you make? You can make a very coarse two-level distinction. What page has been referenced recently and what page has not been referenced. So with time, lots of pages will be referenced, so this very coarse distinction is not going to help very much.
Sir, this recently will be a time period, like
last 5 minutes. Right. So that's basically what I'm coming to. If you kind of, if you don't do anything about the reference bit other than just setting it, after a while everybody is going to look the same. Mm-hmm. So which means periodically all reference bits will have to be cleared. So then what your reference bit tells you really is, think of some interval delta t, and after every delta t, the reference bits are clear. So during any interval, your reference bit will tell you whether or not the page has been referenced in the current delta t interval. So notice that towards the beginning of the interval, nothing looks like it has been referenced. So there also, the choice will have to be made based on some other criterion, like maybe FIFO.
Delta
beta,
how much will be delta beta?
Sorry?
How much will be this delta
beta? Hard question. I mean, it's a parameter like any other operating system parameter. So maybe something like 1000 memory references. But that's just a random figure that I'm telling you off the top of my head. Right. So
it's actually dependent on the human, basically.
I'm sorry?
So it is basically dependent on the human user.
Well, I mean, you can't expect, so you could do it on kind of memory references, but well, really, I mean, I should backtrack, because what I said earlier was, maybe not, it will be hard to edit. Okay, so what I'm trying to say is, if you want to implement this in software, then again, notice we'll need an increment operation on every memory reference. So that's not good. You get what I mean? I mean, if you're keeping track of whether 1,000 memory references have elapsed or not, and you're doing that in software, then on every memory reference that counter will have to be incremented. That's not good. So what alternative do we have? Either you can do it timer-based, which means kind of when you have a timer elapses, say every 10 milliseconds or so, maybe less, all reference bits are cleared. That is one possibility. The other possibility would be to assume hardware support, which is the MMU can keep track of how many memory references are happening. So every time an address translation happens in the MMU, some hardware counter inside the MMU is incremented. So when that overflows, you know that it is time to clear all memory, all reference bits. So I mean, given a choice between the two, I'd say it's probably better to have it in hardware, but then of course that's kind of design dependent. You need to assume that kind of support from your hardware.
Sir, all of the pages having reference bit 1, so they all will have equal priority.
Correct. So which means that because you're making a very coarse distinction, you have to break ties. What do you break ties based on? Something like FIFO. So really, even though I didn't say that, but strict LRU will not have the Bell-Edis anomaly problem. For reasons that we are not going to go into now, but strict LRU does not have the...
Sir, but is it sure, like, it will not happen such that a reference bin is being set and reset before the page is being referenced or something?
No, sorry, say that again.
The reference bit is set for a page. Then, sir, say, there are a few pages for which the reference bit is set. Now, say, sir, the memory reference count becomes 1,000 and the reference bit are all reset. So, many of the pages will have a reset reference bit.
All of them,
yes.
Right?
Sir, then, like, will it not be like it might delay? Like, you need, like, say, the 1,001st reference, you need a page.
Absolutely. So that's what I said. I mean, if you are resetting everything periodically, then when a new period has just started, everything looks equally bad. So, and if you're doing FIFO replacement, you might actually end up replacing the wrong page. So, I mean, suppose, think of code that does something like the following. I mean, you have a small loop that iterates over a very large array. So that the page corresponding to the code for that loop is going to be brought in very early, and the pages for pieces of the array are going to be brought in later. So from kind of reference point of view, this one is going to be referenced on every instruction fetch, whereas the array will be kind of, you'll step through the array. So if you are kind of just after the beginning of an interval where everything is looks equally bad and you're breaking ties by FIFO, you will actually end up replacing the code page only to bring it back on the next instruction. So yes, that could definitely happen. I mean, it's the price to pay for having a coarse kind of reference, a coarse counter. Right, so the obvious extension of this is instead of, so remember here, we now have 5 plus 1, 6 bit is the reference bit. We still have 7 bits left over. So assuming that we don't need any other, to store any other auxiliary information here, what we could do is the remaining 8, we use all of them as reference bits. So how does this work? This is basically the first formal, I mean, think of the reference bit as the the zeroth approximation to LRU, and this is the first reasonable approximation to LRU. So what we do is think of these 8 bits here. So initially everything is clear. What we do is every time there is a memory reference, so think of kind of we still have some delta t. So if there is a reference, we set the highest order bit over here. So earlier in the kind of nicest possible approximation, we were setting this and clearing it periodically. What we do now is we set this on a reference, but after delta t, instead of erasing this, we shift this right. So then what you have is these 8 bits store the history of so this is the current delta t and this is the 8th preceding delta t. So you have, using these additional reference bits, and I mean coincidentally we have 8, so you could also call it a reference byte. This keeps the history of the page over the last 8 delta t intervals. So that's a little more detailed information than just what is happening in the current interval. So now if you regard this as a number, then a large number means what? The higher order bits are set, which means that it has been relatively recently accessed. So if you just sort the or you look for the highest possible entry over here, you'd be getting the page that has been referenced most recently. Once again, you could have ties naturally. So kind of the history breaks ties to a certain extent, in the sense that maybe you have a picture like this, and with only a single reference bit, you would have no way of breaking ties here other than FIFO. But what you can do now, since you are comparing them as numbers, you have something like this has been referenced in the 2 most recent intervals. This was not referenced in the last delta t. So this is probably a better candidate for replacement. Of course, if you are unlucky, then you would have, I mean, the best candidate, there could be multiple things with the same bit pattern, in which case you would have to break ties by 50.
So what you're saying is that the patterns are matching to a large extent, that means the scan has to
work in general. So this is basically just a question of doing a regular maximum finding on an array. So you just, I mean, if you have some means of quickly extracting this byte, you're just looking at kind of find the maximum over this array. And if you, I mean, basically it's something like you have if c greater than max, then max equal to c, right? I mean, this is the standard maximum finding loop. So notice that this automatically, assuming that your entries are stored in FIFO order, this is automatically going to give you a tie breaking by FIFO. So this maximum finding, again, remember that the maximum finding is going to run during a page fault, and therefore is relatively more affordable. Some way of, I mean, notice I'm saying that on every reference, this bit has to be updated or it has to be set, and periodically it has to be right shifted. That right shift notice has to happen for all page table entries. So that means that's a fairly substantial operation that you are incurring every delta t units of time. plus, I mean, think about how you're going to take care of this updating page table entry every time the page is referenced. I think what would make most sense is to do the updates. Okay, if you have a TLB miss, then in any case you are going to have to go to memory. What's probably the most reasonable thing to do is to update only the TLB entries. Then when you have a TLB miss, if a TLB entry has to be replaced, then write that updated TLB entry back to memory. Right, so if you do that, then the actual memory reference happens when? I think these are the two situations where, I mean, remember we were warning against having to do a memory write or a memory update on every memory reference. That would be prohibitively expensive. So the workaround that we can think of is have this update happen only to TLB entries. That is simple because the TLB is sitting inside the MMU. So every time the MMU is doing an address translation, it updates the appropriate reference bit here. If the TLB is full and you encounter a TLB miss, then you have to fetch a page table entry from memory and store it in the TLB, which means you're going to overwrite some existing TLB entry. So in this situation, the TLB entry that is going to be overwritten will have to be written back to memory. The other situation is when you have a page fault, then remember the current information about the set of pages that are mapped via the TLB, all of that is in the TLB. So all those things will have to be updated to memory. Again, a page fault is, since it's an expensive operation, we can probably put up with that overhead. So I think that would kind of minimize the amount of writing that you would have to do in order to keep the reference bit or the reference byte updated.
Sir?
Yes.
If you have the same reference byte, then we use FIFO to break the type. But where is the information? FIFO means which is before that one? Where is the information? Because it is not in sequence. It can be, new process can be entered middle. So we need some.
So then I think what you need is you need another
yes.
table, which would, I mean, the page table you don't want to touch because the page table having it in page number order makes address translation much more efficient. So you want to keep another table which will keep track of, for the pages in memory, what time they were brought in. So basically that will be something like a queue and they will point to particular page table entry. Second approximation is something called a second chance algorithm. So this is actually more like, the basic algorithm is FIFO, and then you kind of bring in some idea from LRU into this algorithm. So the idea is something like, you start with the data structure that the FIFO replacement method uses, which is to say you have a queue of pages. And for convenience, you maintain that as a circular queue, and you keep track of the head. So this is the, suppose that this is the first page that was brought in, and this is the page that was brought in most recently. So FIFO would blindly select this as the victim. What we do with second chance is, instead of straight away selecting this as a victim, we look at the reference bit. If the reference bit is 1, then okay, it's brought in a long time ago, but it's been referenced relatively recently. So we clear this bit and move forward to the next page. So what happens, the moment you move your pointer forward and you clear the reference bit, so this essentially becomes now the last page in the queue. So the recent reference kind of serves the purpose of pretending as if this page was brought in recently. So you keep doing this. So this is also has been relatively recently referenced. Clear it and move the pointer forward. So everything that has been relatively recently referenced, even though it is brought in, it was brought in a long time ago, we give it a second chance by moving into the back of the queue. So this way, if you encounter something that was brought in a long time ago and has not been referenced recently, then that is actually selected as the victim. Worst case, what will happen? If you have a small set of pages, all of which you are using currently, then you make a full scan and come back all the way to what was in any case going to be your queue. So all of these, because they have some kind of a FIFO component somewhere, even though we kind of regard Bellotti's anomaly as a bad thing, we end up being constrained to use approximation algorithms that have that problem. So both the first approximation and the second approximation, both of these are subject to Bellotti's anomaly. Okay, one additional, we've run out of bits here.
So what did we have? 8k means 2 power 13, right? So 13 extra, in some sense, extra bits. So we've broken this up so far as three permission, one reference, one valid inquiry, one present absence. No, sorry. Eight reference.
It's actually useful to keep one more bit, so maybe we'll cut this down to 7. So this new bit that we are introducing keeps track of whether a particular page is identical to what it is on the swap device or whether the memory copy has been updated. So this has to be, remember, the dirty bit has to be updated on every memory write. Once again, I imagine what you would do is, the MMU is translating all addresses, so it knows, and indeed the whether it is a read request or a write request, that is also going through the MMU. So the MMU knows which page you are referencing, and for read or write, what operation you are referencing it for. So the MMU is going to verify address translation, is going to set the dirty bit on the appropriate page table entry when that same two cases here, on a page fault or on a TLB miss, if that entry is being requested, you write it back to the memory copy of the page table. During a page fault, if you find that the page is dirty, then you know that it's changed since it was brought in. So then you'll need a write of the victim page. Then you can read in the page into that return, the main page into that return page. If the data DBT is clear, then you don't have to worry about the initial value. So here also, instead of using just the reference bit, we could use kind of the reference bit dirty bit pair. So naturally 00 is the best page to replace because it's not been referenced recently, and in any case if you choose this as the bit, you don't have to worry about writing back to scrap device. This is the worst because it's been recently used and it's dirty, so it could involve an additional error. In between you have 01 or 10. Out of that, I think the one that's been recently used and clean is the kind of, it's likely to be used again, so you don't want to lose this. Whereas something that's been not recently used, even if it involves a write, you're probably going to select this as the preferred. So we'll, okay, I might as well discuss this in the same context. So there's another small trick that we can use in order to, I mean, that's kind of used in combination with the dirty bit. So this is an, like I said, this is a trick for improving page fault handling. So what the kernel does is, it maintains a like, it's something like, in any case there is a free frame list. So some entries over here, basically as long as we have entries in this part, then notice a page fault, I mean when a page fault happens, you don't need a victim because one of these free frames can be allocated to hold the missing page. It's only when you run out of free frames that a victim has to be selected. So what this trick involves is, in the free frame list, some handful of entries, maybe 3, 4, keep them on reserve. So when you reach this point, even though there are still some 3, 4, 5 entries left on the free frame list, you start looking for victim frames. Why is that? If the victim page that we find is dirty, then notice we have to write it back first and then we can read in the required page over here. So instead what we do is we use some page over here to to hold the page that is required. And the dirty victim that was replaced, that you write in the background. When the write completes, add that to this pool. So this is something like, so basically the process that incurred the page fault, we can restart it a little earlier. You don't have to wait for the write to complete. Bring in the page that you need and restart the process. In parallel, the kernel will be writing back the dirty page. When it's done, add it to this pool.
There are a few other, so basically we are, I mean, even though we criticize FIFO for having Melody's anomaly, we are kind of forced to fall back on approximations to LIU that we'll have that anomaly anyway. Some other page replacement schemes based on frequency have also been proposed, but it appears that they don't work very well in practice. So you have least frequently used. So basically here again we have a counter which keeps track of how many times a page has been referenced. Anything that has not been referenced very many times is a good candidate for replacement. The argument against this is that suppose you are just, I mean you've called a procedure. So the page containing the code for that procedure has just been brought in and maybe you fetched one instruction from that page. But you're going to use that page, so the fact that its frequency is only one or two is actually not indicative that it's not a required page. So any time you move into a new portion of the code, its count is going to be low. So that kind of gives rise to the most frequently used algorithm, which argues that if it's been used already very many times, you probably don't need it, and you can clearly see that that argument is also flawed. So as I said, I mean it's not very surprising that in practice these algorithms don't perform very well. One issue that we've been kind of implicitly assuming in all of this discussion, particularly if you remember the exercise we did in order to show Bellady's anomaly, in fact, to that example, we had a reference tree, which is basically a sequence of page numbers. Then you have, number of pages allocated to the process. So these were the two inputs that we used. And then we computed how many of the page references resulted in page faults. So notice that when we are talking about number of pages allocated to a system, or to a process, and we worked out an example with 3 and an example with 4. What we are assuming there is that the victim page was always selected from the process which incurred the page fault. So that's actually formally given a name. It's called a local page replacement. Any process that incurs a page fault, the victim page comes from the same process. Of course, then if you have a local, you could have a global variant of this. So with global page replacement, the victim frame could actually come from some other process as well. Now, in principle, global page replacement, remember, in principle, it could be better because you are looking at more processes. So it's possible that, say, think again of the example I talked about earlier. You're doing some operation on a big array, a big matrix. So while that program is running, it requires many pages, maybe one or two for the code, and many pages to hold the matrix that it is stepping through. After a while, when that computation is done, and say you calculated something like the principal eigenvalue or something, so
So then the matrices are no longer required. So then the memory requirement shrinks. Now, if we don't do global page replacement, then, I mean, when we allocated the process some n number of frames, now we may actually require less than n frames, but it would still continue to be allocated that many and would be using fewer. So that's actually relatively poor utilization of resources. So if you base your decision on more information across multiple processes, again, in principle, you might end, or you expect that you would use, make better use of memory. But from principle, when you start thinking about what it involves in practice, notice that anything like LRU for within one process, that itself was problematic enough. Imagine now, I mean, okay, a page fault is expensive, so we've been less concerned about what we do during a page fault handler, within a page fault handler. But imagine having to go through the page tables of all processes. So that's kind of overdoing it, right? So even though, as I said, in principle this might lead to better utilization, I don't think it's really a practical policy to adopt. So in practice, I think we end up always doing local page replacement. One question that kind of arose implicitly in the discussion that we just had again, kind of think back to the example I was talking about. You have some code doing a big matrix computation. After the computation is over, you have some small set of values that you are dealing with. So what I said was, initially when the matrix computation is happening, your memory requirement is n frames. When the computation is over and you are dealing with a smaller set of values, the process requires small n frames. And assume that capital N is much larger than small n. So the question that's implicit here is, how many frames did the process initially start with? In pure demand paging, we've said it was zero. So then it starts page faulting. Now notice, I mean, we've run into a problem. We are saying local page replacement. Initially, we are starting with zero pages. So, I mean, something is wrong, right? So which means that even if you're doing pure demand paging, you have to have some allocation to start with. Now, it would be good if we could kind of, depending on how much memory the process requires, you increase the number of frames allocated to it. When it requires fewer frames, you take away memory from it. I mean, this is what we would like to do. At least from an idea point of view, this sounds good. So then, I mean, the next question that we are going to look at in more detail is the question of memory allocation on a per process basis. I mean, how do you decide how much memory a process gets? So these are some kind of vague schemes that you might adopt, none of which is a very good one. So it's just kind of, it's in the textbooks I'm talking about. Suppose you have, I mean, remember the picture we were drawing? You have the kernel at the beginning and then the rest of it is all available for user processes. So suppose m is the total number of memory frames that can be allocated. If you have at any point of time n processes, you could do just equal allocation, bad idea. Proportional allocation is more sensible in the sense that suppose the size of process pi, we come a little later to the question of how you determine this, but you could do something like si by sigma si is kind of, this is the total requirement and this is the requirement for this particular process. So in if you have this at your disposal, this is what you must use in order to meet this requirement. So you do something like SI by C by SI in multiply by. This is again, I mean, assuming that all processes are equal in other respects. I mean, with regard to memory requirement, they're clearly different, but in other respects, you are treating them all as equal. If you want to bring priority into the picture, then you have some, I mean, in this calculation somewhere, you would also have to factor in the priority of the process. So the question that we haven't addressed here is how do we know what the size of a process is? So one possibility would be to kind of consider the size that you get from error out, except that the executable file is not going to tell you how much heap space you are using or how far your stack has gone. So it's probably better to keep track of the size of the process somewhere, likely in the proc structure. So when a process is allocated a new frame, the size goes up. When a frame is taken away, its size goes down. Okay, so that also brings up a whole lot of other questions which we have not kind of looked at kind of methods for answering. So let us continue with this discussion for a bit and then we'll come back and see what we can do to address this question a little more precisely. So the obvious problem with this is, I mean, as long as M is more or less good enough to accommodate sigma SI, you're all right, there is no problem. Now, what happens if that requirement keeps growing and sigma SI becomes significantly larger than M? So what we have then is a situation called threshing. What does threshing mean? Think about what is happening if n is significantly less than so think of any one particular process pi. Because of proportional allocation with or without a priority component, PI, it actually requires SI, but because of proportional allocation, it's been given fewer frames. Which means what? It requires some number of frames to work properly. It has fewer. So every so often it's going to page fault. So if the process PI spends more time in the page fault handler than in doing actual computation, so that situation is basically what's called, I mean, we say that the process PI is crashing. Every time a victim is selected, that victim frame is something that is going to be required again soon, which means that pretty soon the process will page fault again, and each page fault will require some time to bring the required page back into memory. So only in between, you do a little computation and again the process ends up requiring a page that's not there. So in this context, if you now think about local versus global page replacement, we get yet another, I mean, we've already argued against global replacement. Now, what might happen is that if you're doing local replacement, then kind of what might happen is that, I mean, the process that is crashing may or may not affect other processes. I mean, suppose you have a situation where, I mean, we started out by assuming this, but supposing this is the situation, and one particular process, its requirement suddenly increases. So it doesn't have enough frames to hold all the pages that it needs right now. So that process is going to start crashing fine. But because we are always selecting victims from that process itself, it is not affecting other processes. So the other processes continue to work normally. So in some sense, local replacement prevents thrashing from being contagious. Whereas if you're doing global replacement, then this growing process will take away frames from others, and kind of they were happy, but now they've lost their frames, so they also start thrashing. So the thrashing spreads to other processes also. And the bad thing about thrashing is, I mean, not only is PI spending more time in the page fault handler than in computation, if you have multiple processes thrashing, they are all trying to do what? They're all trying to do disk IO from the swap device. So then the queue there also will grow in length. So kind of, that's a secondary bad effect that, widespread thrashing has. So the swap device also now starts becoming a bottleneck. So those of you who taken this course earlier, you heard about this story. So the story goes like this, that you have, I mean, this happened sometime in the past, which is how people came to kind of realize that thrashing does occur and it's a bad thing. So the idea is, and kind of, okay, let's see what the story is. So the story is something like the following. You have a situation that I described earlier, that you have kind of a set of processes which were running with kind of occasional page faults, and for one of them, the memory requirement suddenly goes up significantly. So it starts thrashing. And back in the time that we are referring to, remember we had things like kind of 16-bit address spaces, 8K pages, 8 pages per process, things like that. So maybe because of that, global replacement might have been an option there. And as I said, I mean, in principle, global replacement sounds like a good idea. So this particular thrashing process starts taking away frames from other processes. So other processes also start thrashing. Now, because most processes are doing I/O in order to handle page faults, they are not using the CPU that much. So the CPU utilization drops. Now, the bad design historically was that if CPU utilization drops, then the system thinks, okay, then I don't have enough processes, that's why my CPU utilization is low. So the bad thing that it does is it introduces more processes that were probably hitherto swapped out into the ready queue. So that only increases the problem even more. So after a while, your kind of IO device corresponding to the swap partition becomes choked, and CPU utilization becomes very poor. So of course, I mean, just depending on CPU utilization in order to increase the degree of multiprogramming, I mean, now with the benefit of hindsight, we know that that's a very bad decision to have taken. So now, I mean, in current practice, you'd also be looking at things like how busy the I/O devices are, how much memory is required, and things like that, before you blindly increase multi-programming. But anyway, I mean, the lesson learned was that, okay, one lesson learned was kind of be a little careful about when you decide to increase the degree of multi-programming. But the other lesson learned is that, okay, I mean, caching does happen. If you do global replacement, it's even more of a problem. But in any case, we want to reduce caching to the extent possible. So fine. So as kind of humans, we understand what caching means. And kind of if you're looking at a system and looking at what each process is doing, you can probably tell whether a process is caching or not. What we need is some mechanism for the kernel itself to monitor processes and determine when a process is caching and then do something about it. So we look at two methods for kind of combating caching. So one is called page fault frequency monitoring. So this simply involves keeping track of how often a particular process is page fault. So that's easy enough to do. Every time a page fault occurs, maybe you kind of keep track of the time at which it occurred. So that gives you some idea about within a particular interval how many page faults occur. Now, if the kernel finds while handling a page fault that the page fault rate for a particular process is high, then kind of the kernel concludes that that process is crashing. What's the obvious remedy? You give it more frames. Assuming that more frames are available, if the page fault rate is high, then and frames are available, some processes, I mean the caching process is allocated more frames. But sooner or later in this process, you're going to run out of frames. What do we do then? So what we do is, we not only have an upper threshold, so when the PFR goes beyond that, we regard it as caching, we also have a lower threshold, which we are essentially saying is that for as long as a process is page faulting at this rate, that is acceptable. Anything less means it's probably not using its allocated memory adequately. So if the page fault rate for a particular process is low, then we can actually take away frames from that process and distribute it to other processes. So basically this is really a much more realistic scheme than the kind of, you could really think of it as a variant of the proportional allocation scheme. Proportional allocation scheme was in some sense static. This is basically the kind of dynamic version of proportional allocation. We are taking pages away from processes that are not using memory too much and giving it to processes which are. As before, if there are no free frames available, but PFR has increased. So basically what we are saying is there weren't too many processes with this behavior. So we didn't get too many free frames. Then basically the best thing to do in order to prevent caching is to select some victim processes and suspend them altogether. So save them on the swap device and distribute the frames that the process was using to other processes. So basically the result is that the victim process naturally suffers, but at least the system as a whole continues working well.
Sir, but won't writing this app device take a lot of time?
I'm sorry?
Won't writing this app device, won't it take a lot of time?
What two situations are you thinking of?
If there are some crashing, but actually writing to disk will take a lot of time.
Right. Right.
So, if you are doing it regularly, then even then it will slow down the system.
Right. So what we are saying is that when you identify that the page fault rate for a particular process has increased, you want to give it more frames. You don't have more frames. So then you select a victim process and write that to swap device. So during that time, the system slows down. But now you feed up more frames which you can allocate to the processes that demand more memory. So after that initial slowdown, you have fewer page faults and the system speed for
it. Reduces IP operation.
That will happen. I mean, right now, because everybody's requirement is more than what they have, swapping has increased. So in order to prevent what you're saying, what we have to do is select one big thing, write it out, and distribute frames. So initially there will be a slowdown, but in the long run, the system will work better.
Instead of this swapping the process into disk, if I take out all the frames from that process and don't swap, only a single frame I allocated and all the frames are I take out from that process. So swapping is not needed now.
Okay, except that if you leave that process in the ready queue, then it will page fault all the time. So that you don't want, right? I mean, you see, then what is happening? Then whenever that process is getting in the CPU, I mean, with one page, how much can you do? So it's going to like page fault again. So, I mean, maybe other processes will not be affected, but every time that process gets to CPU, it will page fault. So overall, that's not so good. Whereas if it's suspended, then that victim process is unquestionably victimized, but the other processes run more smoothly, and the system does not encounter page faults. Scheduling question. So there are no correct answers. Let's see. So you could actually choose it using some of the ideas that we considered when we were looking at 2.6 kernel. Anything that is interactive, I mean, suppose your browser kind of stops responding at all because it's being swapped out, that would be bad. Whereas if you got something like a huge compute bound job, maybe it takes 3 hours anyway. So if it now takes 3.5, that would be less noticeable. So you could use some of those ideas. Actually, is this the last week of classes, or do you have classes next week also?
So we have
next week.
Like
you don't want to do it. Okay.
So how many classes
do we need? Basically, what I'm thinking is I'll need one. Two more classes should be fine. In any case, Friday is a holiday, right? Next Friday. Yes. And your exams start on the following Monday. Yes. I mean, right now I'm thinking I will need 1.5. So one class for deadlock. I mean, deadlock basically, I'm not going to bother with all the general stories. So you essentially need to know two algorithms. So that's all I'll cover.
So this we have 6 to 7.
Right. So for this, I'm assuming half a class, and for deadlock, one class.
So do it in one day, have a little longer class.
Okay, Tuesday, do you have the 11:30 class? Next Tuesday?
Yes.
Okay.
Next week, go
to the meeting. Okay, what about any other slot on Tuesday?
Sir, Monday morning can you take?
Monday morning I won't be able to take.
Sir, Tuesday?
Monday from 4.
I can, but at the end of a long day you want, I mean, then that will be taking a class just for the sake of finishing the syllabus. I mean, if you leave. Yeah, sure, you'd be alright doing that, I don't have a problem.
Anything on Saturday?
No, this Saturday I won't be able
Sunday.
Sunday. See, what about Tuesday?
Sir, Tuesday we have class.
But I don't have a problem. I can take a class from 4, but... How your lab work is related to the exam. So what I said then was that syntax you don't have to remember. So what I'm thinking is, I mean, suppose you bring one sheet where you write down all the system calls. You make your own notes, one page, and you write down what the system calls are, what they do, what their, I mean, what each parameter means, how they
kind
are used.
Of a man page.
Right. I mean, your own version, that will make it easy for you to remember. In any case, syntax is not important, irrespective of whether you bring that cheat sheet or not. But what I would like you to, I mean, after all, many of you encountered problems while doing the lab. So, and it's instructive to understand why those problems occur. So that at least I think you should know. I mean, if your program is working fine, on multiple tests and you've not had any race conditions or anything, then you're fine. Then you know how to do it correctly. If you've had problems, then you should at least understand why those problems happened and what was going on behind the scenes. Otherwise, okay, I mean, the other point, I mean, you can kind of, you choose. I don't have any strong opinions either way. If you want, you can bring a cheat sheet with system call syntax written down. Or you can skip that. Okay, so next class is Tuesday and we'll finish with the morning and afternoon. Normal morning class, and then whatever is left over, I'll finish on Tuesday afternoon.